This is the Mutual Audio Network.
The following audio drama is rated G for general audience.
How do I... I'll skip ahead a bit. No, I can't skip ahead. All right, everybody, into the time machine.
No, you don't understand how radio works. All I have to do to return this is fade my voice out like this and cue the organist. And you see, here we are.
Wait a minute.
63 Audio presents the Old Time Radio Essentials Podcast.
Hi, everybody. Welcome to Old Time Radio Essentials. If this is your first time joining us, I must inform you that this is episode 12. My name is Pete.
This is David.
And I'm Paul. The purpose of our show is to present specific episodes of our favorite old time radio series, episodes that stand out as particularly representative of those series, or as one of those quotable episodes that fans of old time radio like to discuss, either in person or on social media.
We'll open each episode by introducing the selection, describing it briefly, and then we'll play it for you. Then we'll come back at the end and discuss it at length, each of us giving their opinions on its merit, its performances, or anything that stands out for us.
And that's exactly what we're presenting to you, just our opinions on whether or not it's worthy of a place in every old-time radio aficionado's personal collection. You don't have to agree with us, and in fact, we may not agree with each other, but we do hope that you'll enjoy what we bring to the table and come back for more.
Each of us three will take turns selecting a show for discussion. Last month's choice was mine. Oh, God, it was good. And that was an episode of X-1. Just in case you didn't hear it, go back and hear it. This month, it's our new co-host, Dave's choice. What do you have for us, David?
For my very first selection, I'm bringing an episode of Quiet Please entitled Tanglefoot. Quiet Please was the creation of radio auteur Willis Cooper and aired between 1947 and 49.
Debuting on June 8, 1947, with the science fiction horror episode Nothing Behind the Door, Quiet Please remained on the air for the next 2 years before ending its relatively short run. While often categorized as purely a horror program, the scope of Cooper's achievements with Quiet Please cannot be pigeonholed into any one genre. Throughout its run, which consisted of over 100 original scripts, very few of them repeats, all penned by Cooper, Quiet Please was, more accurately speaking, a fantasy drama. The series ranged from the terrifying to the comical. Its most famous episodes, Whence Came You and The Thing on the Floorboard Board, fell into the former category, but more often than not, Quiet Please presented listeners with a veritable smorgasbord of storytelling styles and tones. One aspect of Cooper's show that made it stand out was its unprecedented use of silence and dramatic pauses, typically considered a cardinal sin in radio, and his refusal to stick to any one genre or format. Some episodes, notably the series finale, were slow meditations bordering on monologues. Others, like Kill Me Again and Good Ghost, were supernatural comedies with punchy dialogue. There were occasional love stories, albeit of an unconventional variety, like The Pathetic Fallacy, Let the Lilies Consider, Little Fellow, and Not Enough Time. There was even an episode about William Shakespeare, I Always Marry Juliet. Suffice to say, listeners could never guess what kind of story they were going to get from one week to the next. Another key distinction between Quiet Please and its contemporaries is that unlike other anthology shows, Quiet Please featured the recurring performances of the same main actor in every episode, one Ernest Chappell.
And so, without further delay, we present Tanglefoot from June 4th, 1949. And Quiet Please.
And now, friends, adjust your radio dials to the proper frequency, get comfortable, and listen.
How does he make his voice do that?
Forward into the past!
Quiet, please. Quiet, please.
The American
Broadcasting Company presents Quiet, Please, which is written and directed by Willis Cooper and which features Ernest Chappell. Quiet, Please for tonight is called Tanglefoot. Back in the old days when GI didn't mean general issue, it just meant galvanized iron, I used to be a plumber. There are no cracks about leaving tools in the shop when you go out on a job. Because if a plumber took along all the tools he's liable to need on a job he don't know nothing about till he gets there, he'd need one of those moving vans to tote him. Just the same, what you can do with a 14-inch Stilson wrench and a mitt full of oakum, you'd be surprised at. This place where I worked, well, you ever smell a plumbing shop? Can I tell you what you smell? Oakum, first thing, like creosote. That's what you start with. Linseed oil, that's in the red lead you use on the joints and stuff. You smell of hot lead where the kid's melting down scrap lead into little pigs you can put in your bag. Galvanized iron. Yeah, sure, you can smell galvanized iron. Go past the bins where they keep the L's and the T's and the street L's and the Cuptons and the Unions. All sizes. And 40-teen sizes. You can smell galvanized iron, all right. Yeah, there's a smell of rats that live back behind the bins. Gasoline burning in the blowtorches and the furnaces. And the thing I remember best of all, the smell of the flypaper. My heavens, there seemed to be flypaper every place. I don't know, maybe in the old days there was more of it, or there was more flies or something. Seemed like every place you went, you run into flypaper. Remember that smell? Like varnished with sugar in it, like taffy that got spoiled. Kind of a fascinating smell in a sicky way. Think about it and you'd kind of think, yeah, no wonder the flies liked the smell and went for it. Smell? Sure, flies can smell. They got smellers that'll make a bloodhound jealous if you note it. Yeah, flies got lots of things. Yeah, they got a jillion eyes, 6 fancy legs, wings, and a trunk like an elephant. Only littler, proboscis, they call it. Huh? Ah, not the flies. They can't talk. Boy, how do you break good? I know a lot about flies. I'll tell you about it. I can see it today. There was people living upstairs above the plumbing shop where I worked. That was in the summer of 1915, I guess, or quite a while ago. Their back porch hung over the back porch of the shop. Made kind of a shed where we used to thread pipe, melt up scrap lead, stuff like that. And Ricketts, the horse, used to be tied up back there in the alley with a wagon. When he was working back there, it was quiet and shady and hot. All you could hear was Ricketts stamping his feet and switching his tail at the flies, and maybe the gasoline furnace. Whoever he was working with talking kind of lazy and slow in the heat. Ah, boy, was it hot. I and Herbie, we was threading 3/4-inch black iron pipe.
You want the boat excursion tonight, Buck?
Yeah, what boat excursion?
Crawfish Club on the Percy Swing tonight.
Well, I thought it was tomorrow.
No, tonight.
Yeah, that's good enough. Get another length of pipe.
Hot, ain't it?
91, Jelani says.
In the shade.
It's hot for old Ricketts out there in the sun.
His head's in the shade. What's he hollering about?
Flies, I guess.
You should put the fly netting on him.
Yeah.
Look out, don't step in the fly paper.
Fly paper every place. That Bert Kincaid's nuts about fly paper. Gone stuff. Get it all over the place.
That's where you're throwing it.
You thread up the pipe. I'll take care of the fly paper. You think with all that stuff around, there wouldn't be so many flies?
Flies are smart.
How do you mean, smart?
Well, not fly paper.
Fly paper's always full of them.
And them's the dumb flies. Smart ones look at it and smell it and fly away. Land on people, horses. Take a bite. They'll live longer.
I wonder how long flies live.
I don't know.
Too long.
Any more length of pipe we ain't threaded? Here. I wonder what guys think about. Eating? That's what I'm thinking about. What time is it?
Look at that fancy new wristwatch of yours.
Busted.
That's pretty near noon.
Gonna go home, do you?
Gonna go with me?
I wasn't hinting.
Heck, you wasn't.
Well,
no flies on you, but.
Well,
I made some ice cream she left for me.
Your mom home?
No, she went up to Peoria's this morning. P.A. Bedner's got a sale or something.
Well, I could stop at Ruling's and get some boiled ham or something. We could make sandwiches.
Oh, we got some.
Well, I had to get something, though. We're eating off your.
Yeah.
12 o'clock.
Let's go.
Did you ever hear anything start so simple and easy and not meaning nothing? Don't I mean anything? Yeah, you'll get it in a minute. You'll get a lot of stuff you don't expect. It all started that way, though, with threading pipe and kicking flypaper around and stuff. We had up the ice cream at Herbie's house, sitting in the kitchen, where it was kind of cool. And gosh, I hated to go back to work.
I hate to go back to, but I'd like to lay down and take a nap or something.
Yeah, Bert Kincaid, can you?
Yeah. Wish that was a fly.
Yeah. Go bite Bert Kincaid.
Only thing wrong with him is he's a boss. Flies don't have bosses. Want some more ice cream?
Yeah, at least some for your mom.
Well, she don't like ice cream. Don't you want some more?
No, I'm full.
Thanks. You can set a couple minutes more. It's only 20 to 1.
Yeah.
Well, I'm thinking about flies.
Are you crazy about flies today?
Well, I just got to thinking about it.
Well, what became of your dad?
He's out in the backyard. Gets hot. Likes to get under the coal shed to keep cool.
Like you handle it on yourself.
Wish I had a pet fly.
You're crazy.
Got a pet fly. Fasten a rope on him. Lead him around.
Many little bitsy rope you'd have to have.
This would be a great big fly. Big as a dog.
What kind of a dog?
I like that old collar with Masterson.
If I fly that big bite you, you'd be ruined.
Looking at a fly with a magnifying glass the other day.
Yeah. I've seen one once.
Got the meanest looking faces I ever seen.
Great big eyes.
Jillion eyes. Look at you from all over. Always washing their faces like a cat.
They carry germs.
Oh, sure.
Germs, though. Gee. Well, big fries sure be something.
Sure be a swell pet, though.
If you could tame them.
Oh, I'd tame them all right.
They'll be the fry tamer.
Be as big and strong as a bull. Have to put a big chain on him.
He'd fly away with you.
Maybe I could train him to take me places. Fly, you know.
Yeah, you should think of the educated fly.
Flies are smart.
Fly paper catchers and good old Tanglefoot boy.
Have to have an awful big piece of Tanglefoot to catch this old boy. Ain't that much Tanglefoot in the world.
There ain't no fly like that in the world either.
Oh, boy, if there was.
Didn't you hear the whistle? Come on, 12 to 1.
Yeah. I know what you'd feed a fly that big.
Have to feed them people, I guess. Come on, let's go. Now, remember, it was pretty near 3-4 months later. It was just getting kind of the first days of fall, and people were starting to burn dry leaves along the curbstone. Herbie knew was fixing a hot water heater for Frank and Edith Gibbons, the telegraph operator. Live out there where Washington runs into Court Street. Kind of cool that day, I remember. Mrs. Gibbons, she was jawing at us because she said we were so slow. She wanted that hot water heater fixed right this minute. She wanted to take a bath before the chicken pie supper at Christian Church. She had to put the icing yet on 2 devil's food cakes, and would we please hurry up? She was all of a tizzy. Well, finally, Henry come with the reducer tea we was waiting for.
Mrs. Gibbons, she went out to the kitchen to look at the cakes, and don't go banging things around and make my cakes fall, she said. I said, yes, ma'am, for about the 14th time, and she shut the door. I laid down my ball-peen hammer. I said, whew.
Me too.
Why can't women leave you alone?
Well, I get the union after her. She thinks she knows so much about plumbing.
Well, at least it's cool.
What's the matter?
Yeah, I got my elbow on the flypaper. My heavens, what you still got flypaper around for?
Yeah, let me do it.
Oh, got to take off the skin, too? Squirt me some gasoline on it. I got guck all over me. Ain't been any flies for 3 weeks. I need more gasoline.
I know where there's a fly.
Huh?
I know where there's a fly.
Well, why don't you swat him?
Well, two reasons. First, I kind of like this fly.
Like him?
Raised him from a pup.
Herbie.
Raised a fly from a pup? Second thing is, you want to swat this fly, you better have a baseball bat.
What?
This here fly is 8 inches long.
Huh?
Hand me the red lead.
How big?
Maybe 9. Where are you going?
Miss Gibbons.
What are you calling her for?
Miss Gibbons, call up the asylum. Herbie Butterworth is seeing flies 9 inches long.
Here, under the coal shed. Come on, Teddy. Here, Teddy boy. Here, Teddy. Come on, Teddy. Come on out there, boy. Darn you, Teddy. Come on, Teddy. Here, boy. Good dog. Come on, Ted. Ted! You hear me? Come on out of there. Come on now. Dog. Ted! Come on, boy. Teddy!
He's asleep, maybe.
What, with me hollering that way?
Well, maybe he ain't there. Maybe he's up.
There's two. I can see him. He's laying down in there. Here, Teddy. Here, Teddy!
Well, reach in and pull him out.
Come on, dog. Come on. Buck.
Huh?
He's dead.
You ain't ever seen anybody. Anything, I mean, that a fly killed. No, I don't mean kill by putting germs on them or like that. I mean, well, murdered by a fly.
This here fly is 8 inches long. Maybe 9.
This here fly killed Teddy, that was Herbie Butterworth's dog, that was a hound dog that weighed 42 pounds on John Aper's scales the day before. This here fly, he just up and killed poor old Teddy. But maybe Teddy was scared to death by the fly first. Because nobody in the whole great big wide world ever seen a fly that was 8, 9 inches long. Nobody but first Herbie and then Teddy. And afterwards, me.
I ain't found him yet.
Maybe he got froze to death.
Kind of scares me, Buck. Don't it you?
He comes after me, I'll bat him on the head.
He'll come flying up to you. Come flying up. You won't even see his wings. You know how a fly's wings is. You can see through them.
Maybe he's froze to death. Flies can't stand cold weather. They die.
They don't always die. Sometimes they go into, what is it, a coma? When they get warm, they come to again. And then they're hungry.
Well, I think he's dead. Because we ain't heard about anybody croaking, you know, with a mystery. Not since Teddy. Hey, I can still see that dog.
Try not thinking about Teddy.
Maybe you ought to leave some fly paper around. Big hunks of fly paper.
I got fly paper all around the coal bin there where he was.
Heavy enough?
It don't have to be so heavy. He lands on a hunk of tanglefoot. It'll get all stuck to the hair and
hair.
Hair on his legs. Flies got hair on their legs.
Real hair?
More like bristles, like spikes, kind of. He gets fly paper stuck in his legs, his wings. He ain't gonna go skittering around much.
Maybe he's dead.
Sure hope not.
Hope not?
Well, I kind of like him. Till he ate up Teddy.
I'd be just as satisfied if I never get to see him. It must be quite a sight, though.
like looking at a fly through a magnifying glass.
Sure glad he only got to be 8-9 inches long.
Ooh, I
hate to lose him. I could put him in a circus or a sideshow or something. Make $1 jillion. Take him up to Chicago. People would come from miles and miles around.
To a zoo, just about. Or a museum like that one. Where is it, New York?
Yeah, he was quite a thing. He used to eat mice. I went and caught mice and let him have them. I want to see what he'd do to a dead mouse.
Oh, thank you kindly. I seen what he'd done to Teddy. How'd you get him so big, Herbie?
Huh? Secret, Buck.
And so?
I bet if he'd lay an egg, the egg would be bigger. I mean, the puppet would be bigger than he was.
Fly egg.
Bigger than a hen's egg it'd be. Bigger than maybe a turkey egg.
Maybe he's dead.
Yeah.
Yeah, he comes after me, I'm going to shoot him, my old 12.
Ah, you couldn't hit a balloon with a bull fiddle.
You hit him all right. Hello, Louise.
How do you do? Hey, who's that, Buck?
I don't know. Just moved to town from someplace in Ohio, Iowa, someplace.
Louise
McGinty, McKinney, something like that.
Where'd you know her?
Met her at Empire Hall, that dance the other night.
What dance? Social Athletic Club.
Uh-huh.
Well, night. See you at the shop in the morning.
So long. It's cold, ain't it?
Yeah, gonna snow. Feels like snow.
More busted water pipes.
Yeah. So long, Buck. Say it, at Louise, what's your name? That's something, ain't it?
Yeah, I feel like that there type.
I like it.
Say, Herbie.
What?
Listen.
What?
Listen, that great big fly of yours.
Yeah?
On the level now. Is there a great big fly?
Huh?
Couldn't you just be... Well, I just thought about it all of a sudden. I never seen this here fly.
You mean you think I'm just fooling?
I was wondering.
I was just making it up.
Was you?
No. I wasn't making it up.
I just wondered.
Listen, Buck. I never made that up. Listen, I wished I was. I wish I'd never started making flies grow big. I would have stopped when I got one this big. I wish...
I don't know whether to believe you or not.
Listen, Buck, when I think what that there fly... You remember way back last summer when we first talked about it? You said, what would you feed a great big fly?
Yeah.
Remember what you said?
What?
You said people. People, you said. That's what you'd feed them.
Oh. Yeah.
Listen, Buck, he already had a dog. That we know about. What if he... If he ain't dead by now and all is cold, he must be...
Must be what?
Hungry.
Third of December, 1915. Air 76543, the third, the night Herbie and me talked like I told you. I remember because on the 7th, the Boy Scouts had a movie at the Capitol Theater. It used to be the Standard Theater. And there was a kid with a bugle blowing it out front. That was the 7th. That was the night Bert Kincaid phoned me up from the shop and Mayor Watson came over from kind of next door and told me Bert was calling me. And I was over. Bert, he said, you and Herbie Butterworth go right away to these people, these McKinneys, whichever it was, because their friend or something was wrong with it and they was hollering they was freezing. And I should go right on over and Herbie would meet me there. He was already on the way with the rickets and the wagon and the tools. So I said, all right, and I went home and put on my overshoes and my army sweater, and I'm over there. See, the place is only 2 doors away from where Herbie lived, there by the Garfield School. That's why he was there already, see? I never even bothered to knock on the door. I just went around to the cellar door with my Coleman lantern, and I come on down, and Herbie was there already, sitting on the cellar steps, so I just about fell over him, and not looking very happy. Say, I said, I thought there was freezing to death here in this house with a busted furnace. It's not cold down here. It's warm, I said.
I fixed it.
Huh?
I fixed the furnace. This valve was corroded, and I put a new one on. I fired up. It's all right.
Well, what you setting on the cellar stairs for, then, if it's all fixed? What you setting around here for?
Well, I...
What are you looking so crabby about? Anybody ought to be crabby, it's me. I walked halfway across town. I'm about... What you so crabby about?
Shh.
Huh?
She's down here.
Who?
Louise, you know, the McKinley gal, or whatever her name is.
Where? Oh. That's why I ain't welcome to his company.
Shut up.
Gonna make some time, huh?
Shut up. She'll hear you.
Where is she?
I went back there in the preserve closet.
What for? Going to bring you a jar of apple butter?
The old man makes elderberry wine. Got some bottles back there he bought from Ohio or Iowa or whatever it is. 3 years old.
I sure like elderberry wine.
I know it.
Well, I tell you, Herbie, I'm a good guy. I'm your friend, Herbie. Seeing you got everything fixed up, I'll beat it.
You don't have to go.
I never stood in the guy's way, Herbie. I'll go out into the cold and the snow.
Ain't no snow.
I'll go right home and read B.C. Allensworth's editorials in the Times, and I'll leave the coast clear for you.
You don't have to do that, Buck.
Just as soon as I have one drink of elderberry wine.
No, there was a catch in it.
I'll go right away, honest, Herbie. Hey, you've been telling her about giant flies and things.
Cut it out.
That thing's dead.
I guess
if it ever was alive. You got the makings?
Got some tailor-mades. Nebos?
Yeah, much obliged. Ain't you smoking?
Nah.
What's she doing, making that wine?
Well, man probably hid it for herself.
You give her a good smacking if you find she's swapping. Probably give you a good smacking, too, huh? Why'd you yell at her?
The folks will hear upstairs.
Louise!
Shut up.
Hey, Louise!
Shut up, Buck.
Come on, let's go help her.
Nix.
Louise, you want some help?
Buck, the people will hear you.
In here? Hey, Louise. I thought maybe you needed some... Louise? Louise.
Buck. What's that?
Herbie.
What's the matter, Buck? Buck, what's that? Louise.
I could recognize her by her clothes. By her clothes, that's all. You never saw a person that made a fly... No, you never did. Herbie and I did. A big, not 8-9 inches long now, down in a hot, stuffy cellar. 2 feet long. And fat and kind of logy it was, dopey, like after you had a big dinner. And Louise... Herbie, he fainted, and I... Back there by the furnace pipes. I could see them eyes. A jillion eyes. And that trunk like elephant. It kind of buzzed and wiggled its eyes at me and rubbed its face with its paws like a cat washing its face after dinner. And I tried to holler, but all I could hear was this buzzing, that's all. And then it kind of stumbled out from the pipes and it jumped and it came right past my face and it flew kind of sagging, kind of out of the corner of my eye. I seen it. It flew right out into the furnace room and the furnace door was open and the fire... You don't want to hear anymore, huh? There's only a little bit more. You've come this far with me, so... Well, they put us both, Herbie and me, in jail. They said we murdered Louise, but nobody could murder anybody like that. And there wasn't any other evidence, so... See, the fly was dead. Disappeared, and there wasn't anything to go on. So they had to let us go. That's pretty near the whole story. Ain't it, Herbie?
The egg?
Oh, sure, I pretty near forgot about that egg. And about the egg. Bigger than a hen's egg. Big's a turkey egg. Back there in the dark behind the pipes.
I didn't see it. Buck seen it.
But I never told anybody about it. Did I, Herbie? Nobody but you.
And when they left us out of jail, we come back here looking for it, but it was gone. There was kind of a scrunching back there, and we looked, and sure enough...
Larva. They call it in the books.
You know...
And we took it away with us. And sure enough,
this one grew bigger than its father or its mother or whatever it was.
And everyone since then has got a little bigger and a little hungrier. Is that so, Herbie?
Yep. Hungry all the time. Never let him out to hunt.
Wait. Look at him. Ain't he a dinger? First real live pet fly you ever seen. Here, Louise.
We call him Louise.
Look at them eyes. Jillions of them. Look. He unrolls his trunk. Ain't that cute? Nice, clean face. See the sharp bristles on his legs? Biggest fly in the world. Bigger than a collie.
Bigger than a Shetland pony, I bet.
And hungrier, too.
Come on, Louise. Wake up. He's awake, Buck.
Uh-huh. Okay, Herbie?
Okay.
Go on in. No, you I'm talking to.
You, he says. Go on in.
Go on in. Louise is hungry. That's what's the matter? Can't move your feet? Sure. You stuck in something? Used to call that stuff flypaper. We got a different name for it now. Yeah, no use trying to get loose. You're stuck for good. And Louise is hungry. Only hurt a minute, that's all. Careful, Louise, honey. Don't get your feet stuck in the man paper.
Is Tanglefoot. It was written and directed by Willis Cooper, and the man who spoke to you was Ernest Chappell. And my friend Herbie was played by Jack Lescully. As usual, music for Quiet Please is by Albert Berman, and the sound by William J. McClintock. Now for a word about next week's Quiet Please, here is our writer-director, Willis Cooper. Okay, Bill?
Thank you for listening to Quiet Please. I've got a story for you next week. A strange title of The Hat and the Bed and John J. Catherine.
The Hat and the Bed and John J. Catherine. Next week. So to next week at the same time, I am quiet to yours, Ernest Chappell. ABC, the American Broadcasting Company.
That was an episode of Quiet Please called Tanglefoot, originally broadcast June 4th, 1949 on ABC. David, this was your selection for this installment. What made you choose it?
Well, for one thing, Quiet Please is one of my all-time favorite radio shows from the golden age or from any era, really. And I chose this episode partly just because I like it, and partly because a lot of real diehard fans of the show would agree that this is really the last true great episode of the series. It was only on the air for 2 years. There weren't really a lot of episodes that were not well received by fans of the show, but there were a couple. And the very last original script, which is the episode that aired after this one, is It's just an oddball episode. I'm like I said, I'm a big fan of the show, and I've only listened to it once because I was so perplexed and so underwhelmed by it. And so this episode, on the other hand, is I think a great episode by Quiet Please standards or just by old time radio standards in general. And I've got a lot of notes here. Where to begin? I guess I was gonna. I think
at the beginning.
Okay.
Just start from the top of the show, and if you want to talk about whatever you want to talk about.
Okay.
Go to the middle.
I know you're joking, but I am going to go to the middle.
Score.
I know. So Willis Cooper is from a small town in Illinois called Pekin, Illinois. And I know you, Pete, are from Pekin. And so I'd be lying if I said that that didn't play into my decision making, because
excellent sucking up, David.
Yeah, well, this, as far as I know, this might be the only piece of fiction that I'm aware of that's ever been set in Pekin. Maybe you guys can correct me. Is there a great novel or a good?
I can't think
movie?
Of any other reason to talk
There's
about
another
Pekin.
Episode of Quiet Please that takes place in Pekin and Tazewell County. And it's
really?
The one,
I refresh my memory.
I forget the name of it, but it's the one where the man builds a time machine that sends him back 50 years, and he meets a girl.
Oh, yeah.
And the girl is the daughter of the sheriff of Tazewell County.
That episode is called Not Enough Time. And yes. I guess he probably mentioned Pekin by name, but my memory
I don't think he mentions Pekin, but he does mention Tazewell
County. He just mentions the county.
Yeah.
Okay, well, that explains why I didn't make that connection. Mm-hmm. Okay.
And I looked it up. I did some research on that particular one, Not Enough Time. And he got all the names right. The name of the sheriff 50 years before this episode was so-and-so. You know, he got the name of the sheriff correct and was very on the nose historically.
It would have been freaky if he would have got the name of the sheriff right for the sheriff who's in now.
Like 50 years hence.
His time machine worked.
Well, that sounds like something Willis Cooper would do, because it's interesting to those of us who know it, but obviously I don't think radio listeners at the time would have ever assumed that he would do so much research for a silly radio show about time travel. But
yeah. Well, he may have been alive or may have been living. See, the funny thing is I looked him up. I looked up Pekin, Illinois on Wikipedia. We're way off the topic here, but since you brought up Pekin, I looked up the city on Wikipedia, and it has this list of famous people who come from there. And all it really says about Willis Cooper is that he graduated from Pekin High School in 1916.
Okay.
1916, for crying out loud.
That only makes him 2 years older than my father.
Okay.
Mm.
So, but he graduated 65 years before I did.
Yeah.
From the same high school.
I don't know if we want to go too much into his biography, but I know he was a World War I vet after graduating from Pekin. And
okay.
Yeah, he was a man. He wore many hats before he became a professional radio producer and writer. He was an Army veteran in World War I. He was an ad man for a couple years, and then he kind of started off just doing like soap operas and things like that before creating Lights Out, which is the show that a lot of people associate with Arch Obler. But Willis Cooper actually created that show.
Yeah,
and then there was kind of a gap in the broadcast between the Willis Cooper era and Arch Obler's era. But everyone now associates it with Obler, which is
well, he took it and ran with it and.
Oh, sure. Yeah, he did his own thing with it. Also, there's no episodes from the Willis Cooper era. We have scripts, but we don't have actual recordings. So I think,
that's a pity. That is a serious pity. That we don't.
It really is.
I would like to hear those. I think there were a couple that were remade during the Obler era that were written by Cooper. The Coffin in Studio B is one of Cooper's that was remade by Obler in the 40s.
Yes. Yeah. I was recently doing some research on Willis Cooper for an article I was writing about him. And it came out that another one of the scripts that they used during Obler's era was a Christmas episode that was apparently one that they performed like every year. It was like an annual tradition during the early years of Lights Out, both in the Cooper era and also in the subsequent Obler era. There were different titles listed for it, but I think it was usually referred to by fans just as Christmas Story or Christmas Episode. And that's one that I haven't tracked down to listen to yet, but it's kind of on my list, being a Willis Cooper fan.
Yeah.
Seems like something I should be aware of or should listen to at some point.
Right. So let's get back on track. And talk about Tanglefoot, our episode in question. Did you have anything else you wanted to say about it? The performances, the story itself?
Just a couple notes in terms of One reason I personally like this episode so much, and the thing that I just appreciate about Cooper's writing in general, is that I think he's very good at writing working class characters that don't come off as dumb, frankly. I think a lot of portrayals of working stiffs from the golden age of radio. I'm thinking of Shrevey from The Shadow in particular. Characters like that, or the characters from Duffy's Tavern, if you guys listen to radio comedies.
Oh yeah.
A lot of times I feel like working class characters from that era are not depicted in the most favorable light. And I like that I can listen to an episode of Quiet Please like Tanglefoot or The Thing on the Forble Board. And in addition to being a crazy, fantastical story, I also feel like I've gone through an apprenticeship program. like if I listen to this, I know so much more about plumbing than
yes,
I did
exactly.
beforehand. And I can't imagine. I told myself I wasn't going to bash Arch Obler during this, but I will say one minor critical thing about him, which is that this kernel of a story in Arch Obler's hands, I can't imagine being pulled off in a way that just wasn't corny and over the top and reliant upon, you know, sound effects and things like that. I like that so much of this episode, the music is effective without being overwhelming. The dialogue seems so natural. It just sounds like two guys, you know, working at a job site. And then one of them happens to just be breeding this monster fly that's going to eat people by the end of it. But for the first 15 minutes of this,
it's one of my hobbies. I think
it's testament to Cooper's writing that he can just write dialogue that's so naturalistic that you kind of forget you're listening to a story, and it's almost like you're just eavesdropping on these two guys who are just, you know, complaining about the lady they're doing this job for, or just Ernest Chappell's character is just giving you all this these little nuggets of truth about, you know, his trade, and in case you want to do it someday, you know, it's such an odd way to tell a story, but I think it works. And I don't know how else to articulate it beyond that. I just think it's so unusual compared to other radio shows, you know, from that era or any era. I think Willis Cooper was just in a class of his own. And as I mentioned, the way he portrays just everyday people, I think is so fascinating. And yeah, like when this begins, you would be hard pressed to guess where it was going just based on the first few minutes, because at the outset it's just two guys talking shop, and by the end of it, but you, the listener, or you know, you're being fed to a giant fly, and who would have thought that's where you'd end up? So
watch out for the man paper.
Yes.
Well, true, and let me interject here. The conversations that they had throughout this episode were just wonderful. Like you said, he's talking about the horse. The horse is outside and he's in the sun. And then his buddy says, yeah, but her head's in the shade, you know, so it's things like that. And it starts out with Chappell talking about, you know, you never know what tools you're going to need on a job. So why bother bringing them, or why bother bringing everything? Because you might not need some of it, but you might never even suspect that you might need these other things. Yeah. So, he must, I imagine Cooper hung out with some plumbers for a couple of weeks just to get this sort of, documentary evidence on what they do.
It definitely feels that way. I'm not, I don't know what the guy's, you know, resume was for his life, other than a few
key occupations. I really wish there was more information on him, because I would have liked to know what he did in Pekin
mm-hmm.
as he was growing up, what his parents were did, what they what sort of life he had that caused him to get the hell out of there.
Right,
because it sounds like he left at age 18.
That's my understanding.
And never went back. And in that, I'm very much like Willis Cooper, because I left Pekin at age 18 and I've never been back except to visit my mom every once in a while. So
sure.
Yeah. But I'd like to know if anybody even knew him, or where are his parents buried, so you can try to find some information. Oh, well. Wheels within wheels. let's go to Paul. Paul, any comments on this episode?
No, not really.
Okay.
No, I'm just kidding.
You know, I forgot to listen, and
no, I thought this X minus one episode was excellent.
Don't do that to me. You listened to the wrong one again.
Anyhow, no, I do. I agree with both you guys. For how bombastic dialogue can be on old time radio programs, just it almost does take you by surprise to just listen to a conversation that's so natural that you forget that you're listening to a radio program. You know, you think that somebody happened to have a microphone in a room with a couple of plumbers while they were working throughout the day. You know, it's just very natural. And you're just kind of like, you know, the first time I listened to it, see, I did listen to it more than once. the first time I listened to it, I was just kind of like, well, that was, I mean, it took me a little bit to realize what was going on that kind of stood out. And then when I realized he's not like writing it like Shakespeare or something, but he's just writing it very naturally. And that's like, well, that's, you know, until you actually pay attention to that, you don't realize how rare that is on these old time radio programs for it to be just that fluid. And so then when I listened to it again, it's like, well, that really was really good. The way, you know, he wrote it and they acted it out just so relaxed and realistic sounding. And that was one of the highlights of the thing. So, I mean, I really like that part of it.
I agree with you on that. It's, I mean, you hold it up against any 10 other episodes of any 10 other programs in terms of conversationalism, right, and how how Cooper could make somebody say something and it's just natural. And then you've got other people who are, I hate to do this to Jane, but
say it.
The blade into your body and the blood pumps out of your heart. I put my hand over your mouth so you cannot say anything.
That sounds like Arch Obler to me.
It is Arch Obler. Very good. Yes. It's Arch
Obler. I'm sorry. I shouldn't criticize such an accomplished figure, but just being such a fanboy for Willis Cooper, I just have such a hard time listening to a lot of Lights Out episodes just because it seems so over the top and, like Paul said, bombastic. And yeah. if you take away the sound effects, you're left with a lot of really poor dialogue. And
And then the funny thing, I had never heard of Quiet Please until several years after I started listening to old time radio. And the first one I ever heard was the thing on the Forble board in the late 80s, but it didn't grab me. But then I got an episode, I got a copy on cassette of Good Ghost, and that grabbed me because that was so good. The path of a guy from being alive and human to being murdered to becoming a ghost and learning how to be a ghost and so on. It's just a wonderful, wonderful story that really grabbed me. And it's all the same thing. It's 75% narration, but then the other conversation, the other characters when they come in are natural as hell and just wonderful to listen to. And it's just the same way with, let's bring it back again to this one, Tanglefoot. But the way Cooper could write dialogue was just wonderful. And I will hold him up as a paragon of a dialogue writer compared to 10 other people. I mean, we're talking The Shadow, we're talking Suspense, we're talking Escape, which is a fantastic show. All of those guys needed to add that expositional stuff. But Cooper, he may add some expositional stuff, but it is just flawless and effortless. And that's right. What I love about it. And I'm sure you guys agree.
It kind of goes back to what Dave was saying about how he didn't talk down to the working class.
Right.
And you know that it's mostly the working class that listen to this stuff. And so
exactly,
not only did he not make the working class seem dumb in his stories, but the way he wrote it, it delivered it to the working class without having to feel like we need to put it on a teaspoon and, you know, spoon feed them what we're thinking over here, because they're too dumb to understand it. So we got to spoon feed it. He just went on like a normal conversation going, these people are smart enough. They'll know what the hell's going on.
He appealed to the native intelligence of his listeners.
Yes.
Yeah.
That being said, I am now afraid of plumbers now that I've listened to this.
Yeah, but these guys were – what year was this story set in? 1915. So
yeah,
it's like right before he left Pekin.
Right.
So he may have known guys like this. You never know. He may have worked in as a plumber's assistant or something like that.
Sure.
You never
know. Yeah, well, as you mentioned earlier, I kind of, you know, we don't really know a lot about his early years, but I like to imagine that he had all these odd jobs before he got out of Pekin, and he just kind of tucked away all those experiences and, you know, decades later turned them into these crazy radio shows and made the best of a time in his life where he might not have been necessarily fulfilled. But I could be assuming a lot about someone. Maybe he really liked his time in Pekin. Maybe he thought it was great.
Maybe he did. Yeah.
Yeah.
Maybe they chased him out because he had a 10-pound fly at home.
I had to leave home. I don't like to talk about it. you know, one fly after another was bigger and bigger. And my dad, he was kind of nutso in the head and had to get out of there. But I want to point out a couple of things here. I first heard Tanglefoot just a couple of years ago, and I've mentioned my older brother a couple of times on this show, how he and I share a great love of old-time radio, and he has introduced me to a number of series and a number of different episodes, and he pointed out to me that Tanglefoot was about two guys in Pekin, and I sent David this, for the benefit of our listeners, I sent David and Paul this map that I found of Pekin that was made in the 40s, and it's a street map, and it shows all of these streets that are mentioned in this episode. And he mentions, for example, when Washington Street ends at Court Street, that is real. That's Washington Street is in Pekin, and it ends at Court Street. And Court Street, Pekin doesn't have a main street. It's just got Court Street, which is the longest street in the city. And it is called Court Street because the county courthouse is on Court Street. Simple, simple. And it runs all the way down from the river to the northernmost point of the city, I think.
Okay.
And so that's one of the reasons why I'm enamored of this particular episode, because it mentions things, and he talks about going to Peoria. So-and-so went to Peoria because there was a sale at Carson Peary's and now, which is now Carson Peary Scott, which I don't even know if it's still in business.
Nope.
Okay. So, but for a long time, Carson Peary Scott was a very popular store in Peoria and Chicago. And then he talks about P.A. Bergner's, and Bergner's is a store that was still in business.
It was still in business
in Pekin up until the early part of the late part of the 20th century. So it's got some cool stuff for me because I come from Pekin, and so did Willis Cooper. So there's that cool connection there. But aside from all that, it's a wonderful story about two guys who are just working stiffs, and one of the guys gets this idea about flies. And they have this conversation about fly paper. You guys noticed it. They have this conversation about fly paper. Who gets stuck on the fly paper? The stupid flies. Who doesn't get stuck on the fly paper? The smart flies. They land on you. They take a bite. They move on. You know, it's so great. It is so great to listen to this conversation, because who hasn't thought about that? You know, these are a bunch of dumb flies on this paper. So yeah, and who from the months of June through August hasn't sat in his living room with a fly swatter?
Mm.
trying to catch the dumb flies because the smart flies are too smart to get caught by the fly swatter. So it's all along the same line. So just a wonderful story. And I will say that Cooper cheats because he doesn't give up any sort of information on how this guy made the giant fly. He says, it's a secret. You know, he just says, it's a secret, like that. And you're supposed to just accept that it's a secret. So,
I think in Cooper's defense,
that's how he gets away with it.
I'll do point counterpoint here.
Okay. I think this is the kind of ignorant slut.
there's
enough too young for that one. Yes.
I think this is a concept that in lesser hands would have been very corny. In Cooper's hands, it comes off as great, and I think that's because he doesn't explain it. I don't think this is a concept that holds up to scrutiny, and I think if he were to try to, explain the science behind it, the whole thing would just fall apart because it really doesn't make any sense. But if you just suspend disbelief and accept it, it's an entertaining half hour.
It's better not to know. In the long run, it's better not to know how he made the giant fly.
I agree.
It's almost like it's not really a science fiction story that's happening in the real world as it is. It's a story about the real world that happens to have a giant fly.
Yeah.
So, you know, there wasn't as much emphasis on it as there would have been if you would have made it more of a science fiction-y kind of show. You might have felt the need to delve into the size of the fly more and what he eats and how you got him that big, as opposed to the way he took it, which was kind of like, oh, we're talking about plumbing. Oh, and by the way, I happen to have a 40-pound fly that just ate your schnauzer, you know?
You don't need gamma rays or radiation. You just need
formula.
Just roll with it, and it'll be okay. Unless you're the guy that gets stuck on the fly paper at the end.
Yeah. Man paper.
The man paper.
Oh, I stand corrected.
And I love that as well, because the way it ends, it's humorous, but sinister at the same time.
Yes.
Be careful not to step on the man paper. You got to laugh, but it's like, damn, because you're thinking, there's a guy stuck on that, and he's going to get eaten by a fly. While we're laughing, he's going to get eaten by a fly.
I feel obligated to bring up the episode of Quiet Please that everyone knows, which is the thing on the Forble board, only because in a lot of ways you could argue that Tanglefoot is kind of a reiteration of the thing on the Forble board in terms of it's kind of the same structure. It's a guy telling you about his blue collar job, and then suddenly there's a monster involved, and then you're being fed to the monster. In a way, I mean, it's kind of the same thing. He just kind of replaces a subterranean monster for an enormous fly. But I still think it holds up if you don't make the comparisons with the more famous episode, The Thing on the Forble Board. I think this is still a great episode, and maybe that's a good point to, unless you guys have more.
I agree in that. Just let me say this one thing, because
the
jobs are different. You know, it's plumbers instead of oil riggers. It's one guy telling the story in The Thing on the Forble Board when it's two guys involved in Tanglefoot. So, and of course the creatures are different. So it's, you know, it's just a different story. And in this one, somebody created that giant fly, and in Forble Board, it was already living and just discovered. So some of the plot points are similar, but I think in the long run, there are enough differences that it can't really be compared or called the same story with different people.
Yeah, I suppose that's fair.
In my opinion. Okay. Anybody else? Anything else to add to this particular part of the discussion, Paul?
No, I think we've pretty much covered it.
Okay. So, Paul, you have the next line.
Okay, let's vote. What are we voting on, dear listener? As a reminder, we are voting on, one, whether this particular episode is a true representative installment of the overall series, and B, whether or not it is a standalone show that belongs in every radio aficionado's collection. And again, David, this was your selection, so you go first.
Well, I'm biased because I'm a complete fanboy for Willis Cooper and Quiet Please. I think every episode of Quiet Please is representative of Quiet Please. But I do think that this one is particularly representative insofar as it's a story that seems, if you were to describe this story to someone and just not mention the fly, which is basically the first, you know, third of this episode, it would seem pretty banal and uninteresting. But the fact that Willis Cooper is such a good writer that he can give you that slow burn and not really reveal what's going on until more or less the second half of this episode, I think that's just amazing. So, yeah, I definitely think this is representative of Quiet Please, and I think it belongs in any Radio Aficionados collection.
Great, great. Excellent. Paul?
Well, that's good. Well, I'm not the fanboy the other two guys are. This is actually the first time I've ever heard this particular series.
Oh.
But I really did like it. I mean, like I said, the dialogue, the way it was written was so natural. Don't feel like he was talking down to anybody. There was no, I am sticking the knife into your stomach and watching the blood come out of the hole. You know, there was none of that stuff going on. It was just very natural, and it was, for want of a better term, joy to listen to. And so I'm giving it a thumbs up.
Excellent. Steve? Well, I agree with both of you. It's definitely representative of Quiet Please. It's just a wonderful representative selection for Willis Cooper's writing and Ernest Chappell's acting and the supporting character. In there, I think it was just those two guys, wasn't it? Correct me if I'm wrong. There weren't any other speaking characters. Am I right, or was there a woman?
Don't we hear the woman they're doing the job for at a couple parts, or do we just hear their?
You're right. Yes,
okay,
indeed. So those supporting characters were also very good, and I believe that anybody who loves this type of story should have it in their collection. So yes, thumbs up to both of those points. Very good. And so that's all of us agree with each other, which happens more often than not. But it's more fun when we disagree on certain points, I guess.
Next time I'll bring a really rotten episode. I'll bring one Excellent. Of the really bad episodes of Quiet Please.
Yes. Excellent. I love it. Bring us something from Mystery Theater.
Okay, great. Well, this brings us to the end of episode 12 of Old Time Radio Essentials with Paul Arbisi, Pete Lutz, and me, David Feldman. Next time the cycle comes around to Pete. And Pete, for your first selection of season 2, what are you bringing us?
Folks, with the episode you've just been listening to, we mark a full year of Old Time Radio Essentials. I can't tell you how much we appreciate your sticking with us for all 12 months, honestly.
Really? Really? How much you appreciate them? You know how easy this is for me to do month after month listening to you? Never mind.
What are you trying to say, Paul? Right.
Nothing. This is wonderful. I stick the knife in my stomach and I see the blood coming out of the hole.
Please don't stick the knife in yourself. Okay, well, I'm concerned more with the listeners than my co-host in this moment. Or if this is the first time you're joining us, thanks, and we hope you'll catch up on our previous 11 shows. So where was I? Oh, yes. For the next time, as David said, our first episode of season 2, I'm starting a little tradition. As you may know, our very first episode featured the Mercury Theater on the Air starring Orson Welles. So our tradition will be, at the top of every new season, we'll feature an episode of a radio series that had Orson Welles as the star or guest star. Pretty good, right? Huh? You like that?
Yeah. Uh-huh.
Okay.
Okay.
Thanks for your enthusiasm. Okay. Well, I think so anyway. And my selection will be a kind of double whammy, since it's not only got Welles as guest star, it's also a series we haven't featured yet, and it's a rare two-part episode of Radio's Outstanding Theater of Thrills, Suspense.
But you're going to tell us the name of this here episode, right, Pete?
Sure.
Okay. My hair's not getting any less gray over here, so could we, you know...
Hey, I know what he's referring to. That's a reference to the episode. It has to be. Donovan's brain. Am I right, Pete?
Sure. yes, David, you're absolutely correct. So that's next month on Old Time Radio Essentials. Paul, David, tell the masses what they need to know.
Old Time Radio Essentials is a production of 63 Audio, a proud member of the Mutual Audio Network. Find us at www.mutualaudionetwork.com.
What was that?
I lost track. I'm not even drinking alcohol right now.
That's the problem.
Wubby you.
Find us at www.mutualaudionetwork.com or www.narataradio.libsyn.com or on iTunes under Mutual Audio Network and or Narada Radio Company and on any podcatcher you may happen to use.
Like us on Facebook at Mutual Audio Fans and at Narada Radio Company Fans and Friends. On Twitter at Essentials Old. If you want to suggest a future episode, write us at f6.3@gmail.com. That's the letter F. The number 6, the word boink, and the number 3 at gmail.com. Put the words essentials in the subject line.
By the way, guys, we did get an email last month from Essential Listener Zach. He listened to our X-1 episode and suggested that we run the BBC adaptations of Isaac Asimov's Foundation trilogy. Unfortunately, I had to tell Zach that since that production was made in 1973, it didn't qualify as old-time radio. I mean, it was probably made before he was born, so it is kind of old, but we're keeping our focus on shows made between the 1930s and the 1950s for the most part. But thanks for writing, Zach, and please do send us more suggestions. As for the rest of you, if you didn't catch our email when Paul spelled it out, look for it in the show notes. And that's it for now, friends. Join us next time for another fun installment of Old Time Radio Essentials. Bye-bye for now.
So long.
Have a good night. I need more vodka.
Wait a minute.
63 Audio.
This is Mutual.
Every other week, right here on Sunday Showcase on the Mutual Audio Network, you get a brand new episode of Bells in the Bat Free, for which we apologize. However, if for some reason you can't get enough Bells in the Bat Free, and after you've asked a professional therapist for help, head over this way on Fridays. Friday Follies has all the old Bells in the Bat Free, going back to 2006, you know, back in the prehistoric days when it sounded like this to get on the internet. Anyway, if you want to catch the old ancient Bells in the Bat Free, catch it on Friday Follies right here on the Mutual Audio Network. And we apologize in advance for that as well.
The Mutual Audio Network. Listening and imagining together.